This is the extraordinary account of a high-scoring fighter ace and legendary group commander whose outstanding leadership proved decisive in defeating the Luftwaffe fighter arm in World War II. He and his fellow pilots of the famed 56th Fighter Group, also known as Zemke's Wolf Pack, gave the true definition to the term, the right stuff, before it gained its popular usage of today.
Good evening and welcome to It Was a Very Good Year, a veteran story. And this evening, I must say that I have a very, very special person, a very special guest, the oldest living fighter ace in the United States, with 22 kills, 107 missions, 1,500 hours of flying, a true combat ace. Welcome to It Was a Very Good Year, Colonel Christensen.
Nice to be here.
I'd like to read a little bit about Colonel Christensen's background. He was born in Watertown on October of 1921, October 17th. He attended both Boston University and MIT before he entered the United States Army Air Corps. Colonel Christensen joined the 56th Fighter Group in August of 1943 in England. He scored his first victory in November, and by February of 1944, he was an ace. The spring of 1944 saw Christensen score steadily, and by mid-April, he had 14 and a half victories to his credit. His big day came on July 7, 1944, where he fought and downed 10-6 JU-52s. Colonel Christensen was in the Air Force at the end of World War II, served with both the National Massachusetts Air Guard and the U.S. Army Reserve. His retirement is in that of a colonel. Colonel Christensen, to cover your story in the time allotted is a challenge, but I'm going to try to do it. You were born here at 11 Wilmont Street, right down by the Brown School, right down by the Brown School. Your dad was Fred, you were Fred Jr. Your mom, Ruth, was a housewife. Your dad was a machinist working for the Harvard Medical School. Your dad worked and designed the first iron lung.
Correction, master machinist.
Okay. but I do have the iron lung correct. He did design work on the iron lung.
Yes.
You then went to the Brown School and the Marshall Spring School. And you went up to Watertown High School with the class of 1940. You played a little football, and who was your coach?
Dan Sullivan.
And known by what?
Dirty Dan Sullivan.
Dirty Dan Sullivan. And why was it Dirty Dan Sullivan?
Because he taught us all the rotten things you can do to win a ball game.
Some of your teammates, Watertown legend, Victor Palladino. You remember Victor Palladino?
Sure.
Yeah, he was a, what position did he play? Do you remember?
I think he was a guard.
I believe you're correct. And your quarterback was who? With Billy Boyce, does that sound familiar?
Yeah, I don't know if he was the one, but maybe it'll come to me. Oscar Kadarian.
Oscar Kadarian, a baseball legend.
Yeah.
He was a year behind you, ahead of you. He was class of 1939. You remember Oscar?
Sure.
Well, one of your classmates was won the Bill Shannon.
Yeah.
Bill Shannon won the Navy Cross at Iwo Jima. It's, and we have a picture of both you and Bill. It was taken in the Boston Globe, which we're going to share with the audience. But after you graduate Watertown High School in 1940, you go over to Boston University and you major in engineering. Then you transfer over to MIT for kind of a pre-aviation orientation, is that correct?
Yeah.
Now, after you finish, you go into the Air Force, United States Army Air Force, as an aviation cadet. Your first base is Maxwell, Alabama, where you spent 4 months.
Maxwell Field, Alabama,
where you spend roughly 4 months in primary training. Do you remember what kind of aircraft you were training? You were training on down at Maxwell?
We didn't fly at Maxwell.
You didn't fly at Maxwell.
Strictly ground.
Ground classes.
Yeah.
You're learning to be an Air Force.
Well, you learned code. Uh-huh. And you learned math, and which is very important. Mm-hmm. And any kid going to school today does well to pay attention in class, mm-hmm. because it's useful. Mm-hmm. I had to use it because I was plotting the bombers, where we were supposed to rendezvous with them, mm-hmm. and we used both algebra and trigonometry for that.
Mm-hmm. Let me take you back before you actually went to the military. You had some flight training as a young boy. You soloed an aircraft at how old were you?
14.
14 years old, and that was a friend of yours. Father had a biwing airplane down in
yeah, open cockpit biplane.
But you had flown some like almost 100 hours.
Yeah,
I mean that's quite an advantage going into aviation training. To some advantage anyway. You knew how to fly an airplane. So now you go to Arcadia, Florida for basic flying. Is that correct?
No, for combat training.
For combat training. Well, where did you go to basic flying? First, when you first get in an Army aircraft.
What?
When you first got into basic flight training, do you remember where you were? Where that was? Wasn't that in Florida?
Arcadia, Florida.
Arcadia, Florida, where you first started flying.
Yeah.
And 70% of your class washed out, 70% of the cadets washed out.
Yeah.
But you weren't one among them. You moved on to advanced training. Mm-hmm. At the same field?
No.
Where was that?
In Greenville, Mississippi.
Greenville, Mississippi. Is that the first time you flew the P-40?
No, that was an advanced training.
Advanced training, P-40.
Yeah.
Now that's what when you talk about the P-40, you're talking about the aircraft that you see, the Flying Tigers.
Right.
That aircraft, was it Curtis, was it? If I recall, do you recall them? Was it a Curtis aircraft?
Yeah.
So now you finish advance, and does that mean you're a second lieutenant now with your wings, or you still have to go down another step?
No, actually, my class included sergeants, flying sergeants, and not all the cadets became second lieutenants. Just a certain number did. And I was fortunate to be one of them.
So you were commissioned second lieutenant?
Yeah.
And is that when you went to Dothan, Alabama, as a second lieutenant?
Yeah.
And you were training on the P-39 and the P-47?
Right, that's down across the city, Florida.
Mm-hmm. So so the P-47 became your aircraft.
Well, it's the airplane that I wanted, and very few people get what they want in the military, I'll tell you that. Mm-hmm. But that was the airplane I wanted. It was the mission that I wanted, everything that I wanted ever since I was a little child that I can remember wanting to be as a fighter pilot.
Mm-hmm. And your hero was who? As a young boy?
What?
Who was your aviation hero as a young boy?
My hero was Baron Manfred von Richthofen, who had 80 victories in World War I. In fact, I used his tactics in World War II and found out that they were better than what we were being taught.
Well, what...